All right, so we're going to talk about some problems in church tech production today. Ooh. And to do so, we brought in the big gun.
Oh, yeah.
We got rid of the chuckle bucks and chuckle box and brought in the big gun.
Blake, what is a chuckle
box? A chuckle box is what activates your chuckle box, which we just
and
saw.
Chuckle bucks is less than big bucks.
Correct, but they still spend in Vietnam. Now, speaking of someone else who blew a lot of money in Vietnam, we've got Brian DeShawn with us today, who is our, what do you call yourself, chief of staff, head Toby
yes.
fixer?
Toby Whisperer, maybe?
That's a good one.
That's a good one. But yes, Toby relies on me to provide all the leadership to church gear he doesn't want to do.
See, but he could do it. Toby could do it. He just doesn't want to do it. That's why
right.
he has us.
Right.
So, Drew, I think you want to tee Brian up for some questions?
Yeah, so we got some questions for you today, Brian.
Thank
number,
you.
Number one.
Let me have it.
All right. Budget versus vision. The problem being that your actual production budget doesn't line up with your leadership's vision. So do you have a solution for that?
I'll have a solution that's maybe just entered into conflict management, you know, because if a vision and budget can always come in conflict, sometimes a vision is bigger than a budget, sometimes a budget's bigger than the vision. So the one thing I always teach people to start with is design is center, not sides. Typically, when you have a vision and a budget, you have two sides. And oftentimes, people want to go in and argue their side as opposed to designing a center. What do we agree on first? Hmm. Where are the things we can find some commonalities? And you build out from the commonalities as opposed to trying to compromise from your conflict you have on the outsides going in. So I always say first, start design as center. What are the things where your vision, your budget do come in an agreement? Start there.
Hmm. Mic drop.
Normally, when I'm designing sides, I'm just picking which three sides I want from the meeting three. But Brian sound more effective.
Because typically, you know, when we engage in something, we come in armed with our information, armed with our data, armed with everything we think is the right thing. And we forget to listen to the other side. You know, there's always two equal truths. And so I talk about that a lot. There's two equal truths. So what's the other truth from the other side to see what their perspective is? And it helps you come with a solution together as opposed, like I said, compromising to bite off the chunks of what you don't want to get to something that you do want.
This sounds a lot like some great marriage advice right there.
Mm. Yes, it works for lots of things. It can work for lots of things.
You
but
mean
in this
y'all
case,
don't just tell your wives what to do? You talk?
Oh, my goodness.
I'm just kidding.
When are we
going to
invite Blake's
that.
Wife on
Drew,
this podcast?
Cut that, please.
Not staying in.
And the other thing, can I add something else maybe, is that we oftentimes, something we struggle with is the need to be right. That
oh, I love to be right.
I've never met anyone who struggled with that.
And so the vision, the people who cast the vision say, hey, our vision is right. Then the production person, tech person making the budget says, my budget's right. But there's a psychological effect that goes on in our brains that we're attached to the need to be right. I tell people, don't give up being right. Give up the psychological need to be right. And so you have to enter into moments like this when you feel like you're going to be on opposite sides of saying, hey, I'm going to give up that I'm right. Just play that mental exercise. I'm not right. My budget's not right. Then you're more open to what other people might suggest to get you to a solution that everybody can be happy about. That is a very difficult thing to do.
Yeah, this sounds like a challenge for sure.
Yes, it does. It can be a challenge because all of us, we all want to be right. But that psychological need, that emotional state we're in when, yes, I'm right, that is not a healthy place to live in over time. You have to give up that need and attachment to being right.
Sounds like there's a spiritual element to this too where it requires humility. Like you have to be willing to say, like, I'm not right.
Yes, yes, that's the reality is we're not right, you know. But we want to have that attachment to that. And that usually is what enters into conflict with people, you know, is that, hey, I'm right. And if I'm right, then you are wrong.
Mm. That's good. That's good.
How often is that truly the case? Typically, we're all sort of right.
Yeah. Okay.
And if you're right, just be confident that you're right. You don't have to prove to the other person you're right. I remember when you first explained this to me and I was like, ah, that's really wise.
Blake, of course, though, we get permission for him to always need to be right.
Because he's always wrong.
Because, yeah, his need to be right is more right than what his rightness is.
Guys, what I lack in humility, I make up for in excellence. I'm just always right.
Wow, we need to get Toby back.
Oh, yeah.
We need to get Toby back.
All right, Toby, you're back in. Let's go. Okay, that was good.